I chose this topic called FAMAS last year, and it's, as most of you, okay, nobody would have realized, but it's just clickbait actually. Am I going to speak about FAMAS last year? Most probably not. So let me disappoint you in the beginning itself. It's just clickbait in the sense that the math that's involved there is quite advanced. Even the undergraduates in the audience might have difficulty understanding it. I myself have difficulty understanding the eventual proof of Fermat's last theorem. It was given by, we'll talk about the history, but anyway, the proof was given by Andrew Wiles, Sir Andrew Wiles, who has a whole building named after him. As in, he sits in that building, obviously. It's in Oxford, the new building. It'd be very nice for you to just, Google it and look at the pictures. Even seeing the building is a great mathematical experience. Okay, so Andrew Wiles solved it in 94, but we still do not really understand his proof so well. I don't understand his proof so well, and it's a very esoteric, as a guru was saying, branch of math. Fine. So, but Fermat was an amateur. So, I like, I mean, during the time in Infosys, for example, Guru and me were amateurs, and there were several others also. You might have met some of them. We were all like, yeah, doing maths on the sly, by the side. So Fermat was somebody like that. He was a lawyer, actually. He was roasting people in the courtrooms. And when he went back home, he would sit with his numbers. And more importantly, he never published anything. He never wanted to. He was rich, obviously. It was not his profession. And the little that he could write was actually in the form of challenges to fellow mathematicians, where across the globe, actually. He especially liked to roast English mathematicians. There was a rivalry between England and France and all. He was a French mathematician, so he used to post them tough questions. Look, here it is. Solve it if you can. So some of them have been collected, and finally, when his son put stuff together, so I mean, cutting the history like terribly briefly, and I particularly recommend this website. The Mac Tutor website for history. Apart from Wikipedia, of course, this is like really well researched, etc. So it does give the history. They do give history, etc. But the main thing is that, okay, I haven't, I'm not sharing my screen. Sorry. So let me just present, or let me, yeah, I'll present. That's fine. I'm just going to, cut out the history a lot, and we'll get started on the maths very soon. But without talking about Fermat, how can we continue, right? So, and yeah, apart from this history time, don't ask me too much about history, but apart from that time, you just feel free to interrupt me and stop me at any time. I'm generally expecting a question every few minutes. So I have prepared the lecture that way. You can interrupt me at any odd time. So anyway, this is the Mac Tutor. So you can see, I suppose. Can you see what I'm, the Mac Tutor website?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So, so of course, Fermat died in 65. That is the thing. But the point is that he probably wrote this down, whatever the Fermat's last theorem that we have mentioned here. We will have a nice way to understand this. But he wrote it in the margin of some book. So basically, he refused to publish his work. And his friends, there were so many of them across the world, actually. They feared that it would soon be forgotten unless something was done. So his son started collecting his letters. So most of his work is in his letters. He used to write to others. And of course, this particular thing was written in the margin of his father's copy of Diophantus Arithmetica. So we will get immediately started on what is Diophantus or who is Diophantus, etc. So we will have a more prosaic beginning. But as I was telling you, it's clickbait. So I have to tell you a little bit about Fermat's last theorem before we move on to actual proper maths. Hey, hold on. How did it, how do I? Control minus. So basically, here is Fermat's last theorem. What does it state? it states that this great equation, the equation like x power n plus y power n is equal to z power n, the algebraic equation, but you are looking for solutions in non-zero integers, and you will definitely fail when n is bigger than 2. That's what he is saying. Has no solution at all. You are just not going to be able to get it. Like if you start with 2 cubed plus 3 cubed, it's not going to be anywhere close to 4 cubed and so on. And he wrote in the margin, it was very small obviously, but he wrote that, see, look, I have discovered a truly remarkable proof for which this margin is too small to contain. It's in Latin, I think, or Latin or French, I think. Latin? I don't know. I have to have a look at it myself. But his words were also very concise. It fit into the margin. It was even smaller than this, actually, definitely. But what has happened is, after that, people have struggled a lot and never been able to find, forget about remarkable proof. They weren't even able to find proof, any proof. Euler tried his best. Euler, another great mathematician, but in 1700, another name. Euler was even greater than Fermat in that sense that he published some thousands of articles, even though he was blind in one eye. But he couldn't prove this. He couldn't prove it for n equal to 3 also. The proof that he gave seems to have holes in them, holes. So we will have a discussion where what is a hole and what's your proof, etc., etc. But the main thing is that they struggled and they struggled and we all struggled. Did I try? I didn't try. Luckily, I never tried for working on this. But unfortunately for me, the roommate of mine in college time, so the roommate of mine, forget about trying. He suddenly called the whole hostel into our room saying, hey, I have solved Fermat's last theorem. I have solved Fermat's last theorem. Okay, fine. He went to Harvard finally. But no, he said that I had proved Fermat's last theorem and called the whole hostel. I have no clue why he did that. But then the whole hostel wanted me to check his proof. So he could have as well showed it to me in the first place. And I was forced to struggle with his papers. And within 5 minutes, of course, we found a mistake. But the most curious part of it was, as soon as I pointed out the mistake, Shishir his name, he said, ha ha, it's wrong. And he tore it up and so the whole hostel went back to their room. So it was as foolish as that. Anyway, I have done this for other people also. I have tried other problems, big ones, but never for much luck. Okay, so Wiles finally succeeded, it was a very big story in itself. But let's just get down to Diophantus. So before that, why would Fermat even think of such a thing? Any guesses? So now it's the time for you to guess. Where does this silly looking equation come from? I mean, it's so funny. X power 7 plus y power 7 equal to z power 7. Where does it come from, actually? Any guesses?
Ma'am, sorry, sir.
Yeah, go on.
Maybe he was like he was thinking about right angle triangles, then he thought about Pythagoras theorems. Then he was wondering how can you project a right angle triangle in 3D, and then what would be the equivalent of Pythagoras theorem for 3D right angle triangle. Thought how would it be.
Yeah, great. No, how much he thought, we have no clue. But at least he started from Pythagoras theorem is what you feel, right? So that was true. Where he wrote this note in Diophantus' book was a place where they actually discuss what is called the Pythagorean triples. So Pythagoras does come in, and he obviously wanted to see if you can stretch it. And no, Fermat beforehand only, I don't know how much he thought like you're saying, but beforehand only he said, sorry, that door is closed, and he wrote it in the margin. No, that's not possible. I wonder how people can think this far and write it in the margin. But see, let me just remind you of Pythagoras. No, you know about Pythagoras theorem a lot, actually. But the main issue is this, the equations, sorry, where are we? This 3, 4, 5 and, the ones that you keep, this sort of thing. It comes up a lot in old mathematics, like what is called Babylonian mathematics. The most ancient source seems to be this. And any idea where Babylon was? By the rivers of Babylon?
Greece.
Middle East.
Mesopotamia. Where is Mesopotamia?
Today's Iran-Iraq.
Iran-Iraq, exactly.
It is in the Middle East.
Yeah, it is in the Middle East, definitely. But more specifically, it is more or less Iraq only. The Iran region is more arid, and the civilization of those days was clumped around the rivers. So the famous rivers, Euphrates and Tigris and so on. These are the rivers that, you know, are still present in Iran, etc. But none of that maths probably survives, as in they were very advanced in those times. And they are guessing. People do guess that they seem to have some connection with Pythagoras' theorem. Nothing has been absolutely conclusively proved, but I'm giving you an example where we get back to the triples. But there is a tablet, for example, what is called the Yale tablet. For sure, they have a conclusion, something that they have a knowledge of Pythagoras' theorem. So this side is 30 is given. And this side is given in hexadecimal, whatever it is, you figure in base 60, basically. If you calculate, it seems that they have a very good approximation to the actual side, 30 root 2. So at least they seem to have some idea. But what we are concerned about is these Pythagorean triples. So we want solutions to, let's just get back to this. So let me just write it down to concretely. You'll have to pardon my handwriting. Not too sure how well your other teachers write, but I'm going to do that. Pythagorean triples. So what are these? These are integer solutions to. So first thing is, we'll just write them as x, y, z, which are integer solutions to whatever is involved in your Pythagoras theorem. So concretely keep it in mind. So for example, we have 3, 4, 5. If your teachers really, you know, drummed into you, maybe they expected you to calculate each time, but you are the smart one, so you mugged it up. Any other triples that you have?
7, 24, 25.
Cool. Any others?
6, 10. 6, 8, 10.
6, 8, 10. Okay. That's cool. And then something else also, like,
actually, if you take only one set of triplets and you multiply them by some single number, then you'll get one more triplet.
So basically what you're saying is this lemma, or whatever you want, x is a triple, is a Pythagorean triple. Let's just call it PT, because I'm bad at writing. Is a PT implies kx KY, KZ is also a PT for K in integer. So, Archa, have you encountered this notation? So, first thing is, when we say integer, let's just refer to the integers by this set. This is a standard mathematical notation. So, this is a set. This is the set of integers. Okay. If you are not yet encountered it, and you might have encountered this by any chance. Have you encountered this?
Yes, sir.
Natural numbers. Many people have different conventions. Like, it generally starts with zero for certain people, and I don't know, in India we seem to always prefer
zero is actually, we have natural numbers starts from one and whole numbers is starting from zero.
No, I'm saying it's a convention. You are following this convention maybe, but some others follow this convention too. Whole numbers, that word only, is a very old, old-fashioned thing. I don't see it in modern-day literature at all. So yeah, okay, fine. You are going to call this by a different name, but in modern day literature, both of some, like in France, definitely they refer to this as natural numbers and so on. Doesn't matter. We are not going to be concerned about this too much. The integers is very clear to all of us. So integers, D is this set, 0, plus, minus 1, plus, minus 2, etc. This dot, dot, dot also, it has a lot of meaning, etc. But natural numbers has a lot of properties. Now let's just get back to Pythagorean triples. For all k in C, you take a Pythagorean triple and you multiply, scale it up by kx, ky, kz, then it will also satisfy it. Why? Because of this, the homogeneity is special property of this polynomial. It's a polynomial in x, y, and z. So yeah, it's a homogeneous polynomial, and this is something simple. Yeah.
Sir, we can even multiply a rational number to get another Pythagorean triplet. So it can be Q, no, sir?
It can be, but we were referring to Pythagorean triples as integer solutions. So you'll have to be careful. If you multiply by a rational number and it's still, if kx, ky, kz are also still integers.
Yes, sir, it in here.
So anyway, what I'm saying, I didn't say that if you multiply by Q, it is not a Pythagorean triple. So you should be very careful about what I have said. This is an implied symbol. So see, I'm not speaking in any negative way. I'm just trying to emphasize what this means actually. This means that, what does it mean? It's a logical statement. It says that if you are sure that this is a Pythagorean triple, then you can be sure that this is also a Pythagorean triple. Nobody said that, oh, but if I divide by, if I multiply by 1 by 7, it is not. I haven't mentioned anything of that sort. So what you say may be true also, but it's not a generic statement. It cannot happen for any Pythagorean triple. If you're lucky that, so we could, what you're saying is, if K in Q such that KX, sorry. Yeah, I'm happy with whatever you said, but I'm going to formulate it this way. Then KX, I mean, you have to just be very careful. That's all. Mathematicians are overly careful, you might think, is a Pythagorean triple. So that one condition was satisfied, but this condition you have to enforce. Is that fine? Does this address whatever you mentioned?
Okay, sir.
So Q is the rational number. Okay, I am just making a fool out of myself. You people have studied all this in school. The
yes, sir.
Q and Z and N. But in our school, I mean, our Indian system, I think whatever our friend said was there, that whole numbers is zero. This is a little ancient, actually. So yeah, that's fine. When you get to computer science and do discrete maths, etc., it will be automatically assumed that N has zero in it, because there are many set theoretic statements which you have to make it include the empty set also. Hey, half an hour has passed by and we haven't reached anywhere, but it's okay. Let's just see exactly. We were trying to write all this down, and when we noticed this, and somebody happily pointed out the statement. So maybe we don't want all this multiplication. We want to find out the basic Pythagorean triples. Can you generate all the basic Pythagorean triples? That's the question. So question is, so first, before the question, let's just remove all the, let us remove all the common factors. So basically what it means is, if you have common factors, already is there. If kx is in, forget it. So I'm going to rewrite this. If d, let's just say in p only, that's that d divides x t divides y. I'm just rewriting whatever I have said here in another fashion. So I'm very glad our friend pointed it out. Then x by d, and x. So I should have said this is a statement which includes that if x, y, z, I have to write it down as a proper statement because the kids are watching. If x, y, z is the primitive Pythagorean triple and there is the k q such that this, then this. So this is a complete package in itself, I hope. I hope we are all clear here. Whatever I have written here.
Yes, sir.
Similarly, so very similarly, I have to make this statement also complete. So if, so rule one that my teachers taught me, never write in the margin, I am violating. But we are talking about Perma here, who goes to write it. I mean, we are talking about his margin only. So let's just get rid of our teachers. I mean, I'm sorry, but Guru is a good teacher. Huh? We are talking about the bad teacher. Guru and others also were here. They're all very good teachers. But we're talking about the ones who are, you know, like, for example, in class two, my daughter came back with a torn page from her notebook. So it was crumpled also. So I uncrumpled it and saw, why did the teacher tear out this page? And I saw that each sum that she has written is correct. Wow, she has written everything correct and the teacher has torn out the page. Why? It's not written neatly. So this is what life has come down to. Anyway, maths is not about that. I hope you have understood by now, already in half an hour. Where are we? If x, y, z is a Pythagorean triple and, okay, I do have the option of moving things slightly, and d in z such that it divides all of them, then x by d, y by d, z by d. See, I'm not proving anything, but I'm sure you can work out the details. Let's write it down as a proper proof. These are not the most important statements I'm going to make today, but I'm just going to write this down. This is just a corollary restatement of whatever our friend. So instead of k, you'll write 1 by d and you will substitute here. Is this clear? Okay, I'm getting faster here. So definition, x, y, z is a primitive Pythagorean triple. Sorry, I'm not writing anything down. Primitive Pythagorean triple. Okay, that's what I'm going to write as PPT. If it is a PPT, if it is a PT and GCD of X, Y, Z is 1. In fact, it's very clear that this is also equal to GCD of X, Y. Also equal to GCD of Y, Z. Also equal to of X, Z. Now, the important thing is whether I should spend time on this or I should move on. So maybe some other day when we have a discussion on GCD, etc. Maybe, yeah, that'll be a very nice thing to talk about, this Euler and the definition of GCD and other things, which of course teachers probably spent time teaching you in 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, but never gave you this intuition. Maybe. Or maybe you picked it up on your own, but there's a lot to speak about it. It's the first, probably the first algorithm ever written. And it has a lot of stuff to analyze. All about GCD. Anyway, what we are vaguely saying is...
Yes, I think the GCD as a word, I don't know whether they are familiar or they call it HCM. I don't know.
Ah, okay. Okay. Again, this is the
greatest common divider.
Yes.
Greatest common divider. Yes,
sir. So let's just define only. No problem. Doesn't matter. It's the greatest common divisor. But let's define it so that the wording is not the problem, but the definition is GCD of, let's say, X, Y, Z or any number of numbers. GCD of X, Y, and Z is the way we pronounce it, or it's also called the highest common So greatest and highest and divisor and factor, I hope by now nobody has got confused, but they used to, teachers used to really confuse the students. What is the multiple? What's the factor? And, you know, just it's a hurdle, the hurdle of words people have to trip and fall on so that the teachers can feel happy. Again, I'm talking about the bad teachers and not the good teachers in the audience. And myself, I'm claiming I'm not a that bad teacher, but you'll have to ask my students. Right now, let's get back to this. So GCD is, how do you define it? The definition is, you could say several things, but the best definition that Euclid gave, I would like to give you, is written in this following fashion. G is, okay, let me just say, G is the GCD of X, Y, and Z, if and only if. So are you familiar with this, if and only if?
Yes.
If and only if. Usually they summarize in this small fashion. D divides X and D divides Y and D divides Z implies D divides G. And so that is one statement, and G divides X. Okay, sorry, I am pretending like I am running out of pages. Huh? So sorry. I am also a bad teacher in that sense. So I should have written it in the opposite order, but luckily online this can be changed. Let me change it. As you have, while you're watching only, I can change it. This is the best part of my online classes. Usually I make a lot of mistakes in the class and I can erase it without the students getting annoyed. Usually in my normal class, students get annoyed. What is this, sir? I have written everything down. I said, okay, you make some scratch marks. So scratch marks is like their teacher is, they remember their teachers from childhood and say, oh no, I can't scratch on my notebook. Anyway, so now you don't have to do anything. So first thing this means, G is a common factor. Sorry, my handwriting is going to the woods. G is a common factor. What does that mean? G divides X, G divides Y, and G divides Z. And of course, any common factor, for any common factor, we have this implication that if D divides all of these, it's a common factor, then D also divides G. So this is what it means, greatest common factor. So we are, I mean, Euclid, let me just put it that way. Euclid has divided the definition into these neat steps, and you will see the advantage of this when you go to proofs related to that. Today we are not getting into that territory because we have so much last theorem to reach up to. Doesn't matter. I hope you're getting something out of this lecture. My goal is to motivate you to see how life is in the realms of research in maths. So I hope I'm giving that messy sort of vibe. We are more like these artists. I mean, when you think of artists, you shouldn't think of these great paintings, Mona Lisa, etc. You should remember that there are these humans behind whose, you know, face and dress and yeah, everything is covered in paint. It's blotches of paint, and people have, like, you know, their faces look like they have a frown or whatever it is. That sort of thing. That is how artists really are. You shouldn't look at the finished end product alone. If you are looking at research, yes, go on.
Wouldn't it be sufficient if we define the GCD as literally the greatest common factor?
In the sense, greatest is
one strong thing. Yeah, if we prove that it's a linear combination of the numbers, then it follows, the second part follows.
See, that part I'm not getting into, that it's a linear combination. But see, what you were saying is greatest. So you could have easily said, instead of this, you're saying this, right? Is that what you're trying to point out?
Yeah, exactly.
It
yeah.
could have said.
I think this is much a weaker assumption. So it's a fly.
In the writing, but when you finally get down to it, they are both equivalent. So it will be very nice to for you to just check that this definition is the same as the other definition.
I mean, yeah, the common factors do divide the greatest common factor, but it so wouldn't be like nice convenient. To put it in the definition.
No, it is very convenient because of the its convenience in the proofs. So unless I point out, show some proofs to you, you may not appreciate the difference between this, the fact that it's just less than, or it actually divides. So these two are the other one is stronger, as you have correctly said, but it's equivalent actually. So we really don't need to care at this stage. So Euclid, so a word about Euclid. So Euclid seems to have written so many books and so many evolved thoughts down, but he's most probably summarizing the work of several centuries of maths, actually. So starting from the Pythagorean, so the Pythagoras theorem we're talking about. So Pythagoreans must have started out with this definition, but it has evolved over the years because they were focusing on proofs, actually. So finally, this is the most evolved version. So I have just pointed it, given it to you in a platter. Many of these mathematics stuff seems to be like that. So pardon me, but we're not getting into this time. Maybe some other time if Guru will allow me. So next, if you don't mind, shall I move on from GCD? We are getting back to primitive Pythagorean triples, fine? So we are taking those triples here, which are actually relatively prime. So we are going to strike off in red the ones which are not primitive. But these are primitive, these are primitive, these are primitive. So basically, we want to generate them somehow, like our Babylonians did, and wrote it down, write it down in some tablet form, if we can. Yeah, you know. Because if this we can't sit and write down in tablet form, it will just, there are infinitely many of them. Any one you start with, you multiply, you get infinitely many. You don't want to write all this down. You don't want to waste your time. Can we write this down in one tablet? That's the question. And the answer to that is no. Euclid himself told us no. You can generate infinitely many primitive Pythagorean triples. So Euclid, let me write it down in not in red, but in black only. Euclid. So again, we don't know how much we want to credit all of this to Euclid, but it is there in his books. It has that stamp of authority of evolution, etc. We really don't know since when people have been working on them. Maybe the Babylonians, or maybe the Indians, etc. But this is more or less in Greece. So we are not quite sure if any Indian thought has necessarily gone into Euclid's books, but later on, of course. By Fermat's time, who knows? We'll talk about all this later. So Euclid says, any, so this is a theorem actually, any PPT, primitive Pythagorean triple, is of the form X, Y, Z. We should have written it here. Sorry. Why should I apologize? You people are not writing this down, I suppose. I'm going to share this with you, with the Guru, and he can share it with you. This is the best part of online teaching, I have to admit. I really don't have to feel sympathized not to erase what I have written. And, you know, maybe it's wrong, or whatever I said is wrong. Sometimes it has happened. I write a whole theorem and I prove it also. And then by the end, I realize it's wrong. So I erase the whole theorem. It has happened in my classes. You probably sympathize with the students. Who knows? They don't seem to want to kill me or anything. I have survived. They greet me on the corridor and all. So it's not so bad. Okay. Now, any PPT is of the form X equal to. So we can, up to reordering, X is equal to R squared minus S squared. Y equal to 2RS equal to r squared plus s squared for r s integers positive. I mean, it depends on the positivity and negativity. I'll just write integers. Integers which are relatively prime. Relatively prime integers. How's that? So what is relatively prime? That much you might be knowing. Sorry. Relatively prime?
They are prime numbers.
No, they have no common
factors. No common factor. Exactly.
Except one.
Yeah. So basically the best way to say is that basically the definition of this is, so I could have written a definition here, is that the GCD of R comma S is one. So at this point we might say is positive, negative, etc. So for all D in N, all positive integers, or D in, so we are currently stuck to, you know, positive integers. In your mind, you can later on do the negative part also. For the time being, if you wanted to stick to positive integers, then we would have had to take R bigger than S. But that's really not a constraint, and Euclid never put it as a constraint. So I'm talking about Euclid. This is exactly what he wrote. Any PPT is of this form. And there's other way also that if you start with XYZ of this form, it is a primitive Pythagorean triple. So how do we prove this? Let's get down to the proof of this. First thing is an example. So R is, it has to be relatively prime. R equal to 1, S is equal to 1 is like trivial. It becomes 0. One of them is 0 and then you have 2 and 2. So that's, one of them being 0 is not our concern at all. So R not equal to S, R greater than S. Let me just put it that way. Let me make it specific. For R greater than S also is there. So R is equal to 2, S is equal to 1. What do we get? So if you just substitute, you get 3, 4, and 5. So you get 3, 4, and 5. X, Y, Z. You get this triple. If you get R is 3 and S is 2, let's just take it randomly. We'll just take R is 3, S is 1 to start with for our happiness sake. So 3 squared minus 1 squared, that's 8. And then 2 into 3 into 1, that's 6. Oh, how come? Relatively prime integers. How can, okay, which are not both of the same parity. Yeah. That's what Euclid has specifically said. Which are not both odd also. So they are both even is ruled out because it's GCD is one, but they cannot both be odd also. See, look, already I made nearly made a mistake in front of you. So you can't allow them both to be odds also. So there you go. 3 and 2 is the only other next step. So 3 squared minus 2 squared, you know very well. That's 5, right? You get, of course, 5, 12, 13. Because 2 into 3 into 2, yeah, 12, 13. And the other one, now it has to be, this is 4. S one is allowed. So you have 4 squared minus 1 squared. So you please tell me somebody. 4, that is 15. 2 into 4 into 8. So that was 8, 15. And did somebody say something? Okay. 4 squared, 17. And if you have R is 4, S is 2. Let me just complete this. S is 3. 2 is not allowed. So we will definitely have 16 minus 9, 7, and the other favorite, your favorite 2 into 4 into 3 is 24.
24,
yeah, 24, 25. Thanks. Okay, so I have nearly brought some of them from the tablet right onto the board, but here you can generate the infinitely many families. Pardon?
Excuse me, sir. You yes. just didn't you just tell that both R and S should not be odd?
Yeah, I made sure that both are not odd.
Yeah, but when I tried 5 and 3, then it was.
No, it will work. It will work. See, this will definitely be a Pythagorean triple. But if both are odd, they won't be co-prime, relatively prime. It won't be primitive. So you can try that, of course. We will. I will prove this theorem for you.
Okay.
Though we have very less time left. Oh, no, we have time, no? Guru, we have time till 8 o'clock, right?
Yeah, we have time till 8 o'clock.
Okay, so let's just do this and then try to prove Fermat's theorem for n equal to 4. That is the goal of today, the leftover course. But we might not reach there. I'm rambling a lot. I hope you are getting some sense of how it, yeah, you have to grope around a little bit. See, this condition is very important, as we will see. So let's try to prove this statement. So the first part is, I have not written the statement completely. I wrote that any PPT of this form, and the other statement is, if we have this form. So XYZ is the PPT, so I should have written it that way. I can rewrite it. None of you are writing anything down. I can erase. See, you didn't believe me when I told you that I will erase. Here it is. I'm writing it in a more professional form. X, Y, Z is a PPT if and only if. That is Euclid's statement. So if this is a PPT, then you have this form. If you have this form, then it's a PPT. So see, Euclid's statement is so beautifully written. Now that I've erased it, it looks more beautiful actually. I could have erased this also. I mean, but we are not after beauty here. In the writing part, it's about the form of the theorem. So one way is terribly easy. Always you have to do both parts for a theorem to be true. This if and only if. So that only if case means if you by fluke got these statements, then is it a PPT? So let's just check. I mean, there's nothing to check here. It's first thing is we have to show that it satisfies the famous Pythagorean equation. So that's like terribly easy. R squared minus S squared plus 2RS. And you can easily see that R squared, R power 4, power 4. So already you see there is some Fermat's theorem going to come in this setup only, but I will show you later. That's how this expands. I shouldn't have chosen R and S. My R's and S's look very similar to each other. But here it, you have 4 R squared S squared. So, you know, it works out. Right? You all agree. Now that you all agree,
yes, sir.
I'm just assuming that you agree. You people are much smarter than that, I mean, than me. But this was something that many people have observed in the past, the algebraic, binded, and binomial theorem, etc. This all comes with naturally to most people. The main important theorem is the other way. So anyway, let's just complete it. Suppose we have this. As our friend said, if you put 5 and 3, yeah, this equation will still be satisfied. So definitely X, Y, Z satisfies our friend, is a Pythagorean triple, right? So, okay, let me just write it down here. Sorry, I'm just moving around. Implies X, Y, Z is a PT. So I'm putting it down. There's nothing in your mind if you can take 5 and 3 also. The main thing is about the primitivity. So what is the, for example, you just take if r squared minus s squared. Let's just take the GCD and 2 RS. So the main thing is, what can you say about these GCDs? We know that R and S are relatively prime, but are these two relatively prime? So let's just sit down and look at any one. This is slightly easier to handle. Why? Because this is Euclidean algorithm, actually. So you can use Euclidean algorithm says the most simple fact is by using those conditions that we have just written for GCD, we can prove that anything that divides these two, as well as vice versa. Anything that divides this will, these two will divide A and B also. So basically, using just this trivial fact, we can write down that this is also equal to GCD of, you add them up or subtract them, whatever you want to do. So if you subtract, you will get 2s squared. 2 is also very similar to my R and S. So I will change. And if you go the other way, you would have written R squared. So this is the way I should write R. So eventually, I'm just being very fast here. So sorry. Oh. Yeah, that's exactly true. So GCD of these two things actually has a 2 in them. Is that true? Actually, it's not true. Yeah, let's stop here. So what this actually means is, this number, this GCD that you're talking about, G divides, let's just start with G. So we know that G is a common factor of this, so it's basically common factor. G divides 2s squared and G divides 2r squared. So let's be very careful here. G divides 2s, do you agree with this? Because of all these statements, we do know that G has to divide 2s squared. Now the only hope is that if G, you know, has no common factor with 2, G is odd, then we can conclude. So if G is odd, then we conclude that G divides S squared and G divides R squared. Implies G divides, of course, GCD of R squared and S squared, which is 1. I mean, this is all so many theorems involved here, small theorems. We started out with R and S being coprime. What we really need is that R squared and S squared is coprime, but that is, I'm sure you people can handle it. But the main thing is that if G is odd, this is a one assumption we have made. Do you agree with this? If G is odd, then there's no chance of it dividing 2. It has to completely divide S squared. Yeah? So G has to be. So it implies G is equal to 1. So if it is odd, we can conclude that it's equal to 1. But the main thing is, what if it's even? If G is even, then blah, blah, blah. We cannot get much further. It generally will be equal to 2. We don't want it to be even at all. We don't want to get into that situation only. That's why we said that R and S have opposite parity. By our choice, so 5 and 3, for example, if you had 5 and 3, S squared minus 6, this would be even. S squared plus 6 would also be even. So definitely G will tend to be even, right? So by our choice of R and S, we ensure, sorry, my handwriting is getting worse, but we ensure that G is odd. G is not even, basically. If R and S had opposite parity, then we can be sure that both are odd, basically. This R squared minus S squared is also odd, and R squared plus squared is also odd. Is that okay?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Fine. So this is one reason why we had this condition in the first place. The 5-3 was unfortunately not allowed because we wanted to get it PPT. Now let's go the other way, because that's Euclid's statement and we want to exercise our brains so that we reach Euclid's level. See, Euclid is 300 BC and our school system, of course, they could not ruin whatever he taught in geometry. In fact, he has taught a lot of things. He has some millions of books. I don't know, 10, 20. I have to check actually, 16 maybe. But
13.
Pardon?
13 books.
13. Thank you very much. I am bad at this. Yeah, he had so many books. So our school could not ruin. There were so many good things about. They could not, whatever they tried, they just could not ruin his stuff on geometry. But they quickly presented his stuff on GCDs, but nothing more than that. He had a lot of stuff, actually. So anyway, let's get to Euclid's level. Let's do the other part of the theorem. So this is the first part of the theorem. Where is the first part? The only if part. I should write it in red or something so that you get what we're doing. This is the first part. Means, what's the meaning of only if? Only if, I mean, if
that sorry, is true, if, then something else.
I'm so sorry, I'm wrong. If part means XYZ is a PPT if we have all these conditions. That's what we have just used. We have used that X is this, X, Y is this, Z is this. We verified that it satisfies the Pythagorean triple. And with our extra conditions, we've ensured it is primitive. So we have completed the if part. Implies x, y, z is primitive. Also, it's a Pythagorean triple and it's also primitive. Fine, so we have completed the if part. We are all agreed upon that.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now let's get to the only if. It is the tough part, actually. I'm not supposed to have spent so much time on the if part, but you know, I have got ruined by being in Delhi for so long. The Delhi people, I don't know what you think about Delhi people, but I feel that they always spend time on the easy part and they make a big deal about it. Like, for example, when some teacher comes to teach about Fourier analysis, he will spend a lot of time talking about Fourier, the man, and history and geography, and finally reach Fourier. So anyway, I also spent some time on Fermat, but pardon me, if part was easy. Let's get to the only if part. So what does the only if mean? We have to start with the fact that it's a Pythagorean triple, and we have to prove that you have to manufacture this R and S out of thin air, actually. So let's do that. What is the way to do it? The way to do it is, again, algebra. There's no problem at all. Let's get down to algebra only. So we initially had this, and we found this to be a formidable force, and Fermat also, etc., etc. But if you were to just write, y squared is we'll just agree. So first thing is, we agree that there are some very trivial observations. We and XYZ GCD actually is one, implies X is odd and Y is even. So basically what we're trying to say is both can't be odd. How do we prove that? So let me just write it down. Both can't be odd even. Both statements are written in one below the other. Both can't be even was kind of obvious. We have checked before also, if 2 divides this and 2 divides X and 2 divides Y, then 4 will divide the RS. LHS and therefore, etc., etc. So basically, that was the issue, that we can't have both being even. But why can't both be odd? Any guesses here? Actually, I'm going faster than necessary. Let's just assume that we won't reach Fermat's last theorem. I'm slowing myself down. I want to encourage you to answer. Why can't both be odd? Any guesses? It's fine. I have needlessly gone a little faster than needed, that you are unable to think.
Just so, 2 seconds, sir.
Yeah, think about it.
Just know, why can't both be odd?
Me?
No, anyone. You can just think about
it. I just asked you.
Okay.
Okay, if both are odd, then Z square should be even. Mm-hmm. But the left hand side is not divisible by 4, but right hand is.
Left hand side is not divisible by 4. That's what you have to tell. Why? Because.
Okay, so odd number, it leaves remainder either 1 or 3 and divided by 4. So square will leave remainder 1 only. So
If some both are odd. 2. Yeah, great. If both are odd, then, I mean, first there are two statements here. Let's write down one by one. A square of A. So basically, we are always talking about mod 4. Square of any number is either 0 mod 4. Come on. Sorry. Either 0 mod 4, as Vishnu was saying. If it's even, and then its square will be 0 mod 4. Or if it's odd, it has to be 1 mod 4. These are the only two options. You can easily check that and prove it also. You write it as 2k plus 1 whole squared, etc. You can prove that this is 1 mod. Yes.
For the 11th children, just now they are starting all this mod and all.
Uh-huh.
I'll just tell them that 0 mod 4 means when you divide by 4, you get 0 as the remainder. And when 1 mod 4 means when you divide by 4, you get 1 as the remainder. That is all the meaning. Other people will know. Okay, only for the first, just 11th children may not know that.
I know. This model of arithmetic is quite interesting. And this is just a statement that it is of the form 4k for some integer k. And this is of the form 4k plus 1 for some integer k. This is how you have to interpret this statement, mod 4. Yeah, when you divide by 4, it gets remainder 0. When you divide by 4, it gets remainder 1. But if you want to write it in this number theoretic language also, you can do it. Either way, you can do. So basically, it's kind of easy to prove, and you can easily check this out. But the main thing is that if x and y are both odd, then x squared plus y squared is 2 mod 4, which is not the square of any integer actually. So it can be, z can only be 0 or 1, I mean the right hand side. So this is LHS, and RHS is of course 0 or 1 mod 4.
Sir?
Yeah. Yes.
Sir, actually, that we can just take one number as 2n plus 1 and another number as 2n plus 1.
Exactly. It's just a way of saying, if you had just assumed, it's odd, both are odd, you take 2m plus 1 going to 1, and then expand it all out, you will get to the same sort of conclusion.
You won't get it will be
4 into something plus 2, and that can never happen on the other side. Same thing only. This is just an easier way of speaking. And as Guru is saying, you will soon learn that you can do millions of things with this notation. That it was not possible by doing individually 4k plus 1, 8k plus 1, 7k plus 1, etc. This is a more powerful way of writing. Invented by Gauss, no less. is much later than Fermat. Exactly. Anyway, so Fermat was aware of all these things, okay? And not only Fermat, even Euclid was aware, 300 BC, they were aware of all these things. So it's not like really rocket science. We have to move on from here. So both can't be odd. We have proved this silly thing. And both can't be even we already knew beforehand. Okay, so let X be odd and Y be even. So without loss of generality, they'll say, so we don't need to bother about which is X and which is Y, you can interchange them. But for our happiness sake, we never ordered them, etc. I was writing it in order, agreed, but that was never part of Euclid's, rule. He just had it, maybe he had this as even always, and this as odd, see, think about it. Euclid already had it in his mind that this is even. So we are going to exploit that and say that, okay, now y squared is z squared minus x squared. So we want to get down into some comfortable territory. We want to box this equation into a corner and deliver this knockout punch. But let us see if it's really a knockout punch. Usually people don't fall so fast. So you must have heard this rhyme by Erdős. I don't know, I always mess it up, but this is one statement. Let me write it down. A problem worthy, sorry, I cannot resist myself. Sorry, Guru, I have to waste time here. A problem worthy of attack proves its worth by fighting back. So you box a problem into a corner, and yeah, before you know it, you will get that knockout punch. So you should be careful. I have had several such bad bruises from problems who fight back, actually. So let me just erase this now. And we try that. Euclid did it, so I'm sure we don't have any. We're not going to get hurt trying. I have chosen such a problem that you won't suddenly feel that the sky has fallen on your head. Okay, but I have chosen such problems too. Okay, where are we? We got this. So we got to situation where we have y square, a perfect square on one side, and it's the product of two things. So this is the most important place where Euclid comes into the picture. So Euclid tries to say that if this is relatively prime, so let me just say that, remember z, therefore z is odd, so remember that 1 mod 4, etc, etc, if x is odd and y is even, z has to be odd, there's no other option.
Sir, so if these both are relatively prime, then y is equal to z minus x and also y is equal to z plus x.
That you can't say. That is the first thing that comes to your mind. But obviously it can't be true. So it's like saying 4 squared is 2 into 8. These two are different. See, z minus x and z minus x are different. I mean, plus. Unless x is 0, we are not going to get into that happy situation that you just mentioned. So don't lower your guard now. These two are not equal. So you can't say that it's equal to y.
Sir, but GCD of z and x are 1. So they are prime, no sir?
They are prime, exactly. So that is what you have to reformulate your thought process, which Euclid did for you. But let me just try and say that this is not totally prime. So first thing, let me tell you that these both are odd. These both are odd, so the difference is 2 times something and this is 2 times something. So we claim z minus x is 2 times m, z plus x is 2 times n, where GCD of m and n is 1. So, though it is having 2 in it, these two fellows whom we got are still co-prime. So, before our friend can get active, we will first take out the twos, and then after that only we will speak. Okay. So first, now you tell me, why is this true? Any clever guesses?
Sir, if
go on.
Sir, z should be even or odd?
No, no. We have already assumed all these things now. No more confusion.
Oh,
z is
okay,
odd,
sir.
X is okay. Odd. The difference is even, and the z plus x sum is also even. All
sir, because
well
if we assume z and x to be again, any numbers...
Don't go to any numbers now. That's why we came to this situation. So, okay, 2 is coming out. But what I am trying to say is that's the only common factor that we will get. The rest are still coprime. How do you prove this? It's somewhat similar to what we did above. So GCD of z minus x, z plus x is the same as GCD of z minus x, and then the sum 2z, and it's also equal to GCD of z, I mean, whatever you want to say, sorry, I'm getting confused here, 2x. So whatever the GCD of these two fellows was there, it will divide 2z also, it will divide 2x also. So it can only be 2. So basically implies g divides 2z and g divides 2x. Implies g is 1 or 2. That's all. G has to divide 2. Okay, let us put it that way. Do you agree? Because the common factor of z and x is 1. So there's no chance if it divides z and divides x, of course it divides 1. But other option is that it divides 2. So in any case, we'll have to conclude that g divides 2. And because of our choice, earlier we had made some choice which helped us say g is not 2. Due to our choice, g equal to 2. G has to be even. Z minus x is also even. Z plus x is also even. Z and x are both odd, right? So the difference is even. This is also even. So g has to be 2. There's no way it can be 1. 2 is anyway a common factor. Do you agree? So g is 2. At this stage, it's fine. And z minus x by 2, z plus x by 2, GCD is 1. Because we are saying that you can work out the detail. GCD of this and this,
sir,
is 2 means that when you divide by 2, the GCD is 1. Yeah, go on.
Sir, I didn't understand the last part of this proof.
No problem. Let's just go over it one little bit slowly. So first thing is, do you agree with, let me write it in red maybe. I don't know why I like red, but students seem to get worried over red. But it at least calls attention. Do you agree with this statement? Oops, where am I going?
Yes, sir.
Sorry, I'm unable to, computer has slowed down. Okay. So this sort of statements you agree with, right?
Yes, sir.
So basically it means that g divides 2z and g divides 2x.
Yes, sir.
So do you also agree that g divides 2?
Yes, sir.
See, only other option is g divides z. And
yes.
If g does not divide 2, it has to divide x also. So overall you are boxed into a corner. If it divides z and divides x, then it divides 1, we are gone. Otherwise,
okay,
it divides 2. In any case, this conclusion is kind of obvious, staring at us in the face. So finally, we conclude that g is equal to 2, because it can't be 1 also. Both are even fellows. Z minus x and z plus x are both even by our choice.
Okay, sir.
Therefore, it's equal to 2. Okay. What is the meaning of being equal to 2? If you divide these fellows each individually by 2, you have nothing left over. The GCD is equal to 1. That's what it means. This statement, when I write here 2, is the same as writing this statement. You don't have to, you know, break your head at this point. You suddenly go back and you will read it again after half an hour. You'll say, oh yeah, what was I thinking? Anyway, this is what it means. Huh? Don't worry. This part we will assume now. So what does that basically mean? We are going to say that z minus x is, so that's what it means. Z minus x is 2m, z plus x is 2n, and GCD of m comma n is 1. That's basically what we have got. Okay. Shall we go back to the Pythagorean equation?
Yes, sir.
So what does that mean? It says that, see, look, where are we? It's going down. I'll write it here only. So basically, I'll write it in red only. Y square equal to 4mn. Z minus x is 2m, z plus x is 2n. I'm just substituting that here. And I get y square is 4mn. Remember, y was already known to be even. So we could easily say y by 2 and all that. Fine, this 4 we can just divide off in y. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
So let me divide it and keep it ready for you to stare at. Y by 2 square is mn. And this is the part where you can get back to your business. So you were saying 4 squared is 2 into 8. What does that mean? I don't know what it means, but you were trying to say something. So what does this mean? M and N are relatively prime and its product is a square. Just giving you a moment for this to sink in. M and N are relatively prime. And still, when you multiply them, the product becomes a perfect square. Let me write it down as a lemma, which Euclid uses a lot, huh? In black, let me write.
Sir, so it cannot happen.
Cannot it can happen with...
If individually they are squares. Both
individually
are
squares. They are
squares. If U and V are, let me just make it positive, huh? Positive integers, co-prime, I should have written also, relatively prime. Sorry, my handwriting is going. It's almost time. Such that U into V is a perfect square. Sorry, my computer slowed down. Then both U and V are perfect square. So this is a lemma. Why? Because it's somewhat terribly simple. You can prove it by using prime factorization. I mean, the unique factorization property of any number. So if U into V is perfect square, all the primes come in with even powers. And we know that those primes, there's nothing common between U and V. So individually in each U, U and V, the primes come with even powers. That sort of thing. It's a lemma. Both U and V, I should have written. Is this fine? Is this lemma believable, actually? We haven't proved it. We haven't written down the proof. But it's somewhat simpler than you what we have been doing till now.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So with this lemma, let's come back here again. Because you were stuck at this, right? If product of two relatively prime integers is a perfect square, that implies, let me write it in red only, m equal to r squared and n equal to s squared. For some, with r and s, GCD r and s equal to 1. At least that you know. because GCD of MNN is already 1, so GCD of RNS is also 1, n equal to r squared. So we have more or less got to Euclid's statement. Let me write it all down completely. So basically, in red I will write, so that so in black one. X, so z minus x by 2. So x is equal to, I'll write it down. Sorry. Z plus x by 2 minus z minus x by 2. Right? So this is, I hope I wrote it correctly. I think I wrote it m to be r squared. So this is s squared minus r squared. That's the way I have written it. Y equal to y by 2 is y by, okay, let me write it down. Y by 2 square is r squared s squared implies y equal to 2 rs. At least that we got. And z equal to so we are more or less there, right? We have proved that we started with the primitive Pythagorean triple and we were able to get out these numbers. I wrote it in the opposite order, but that's my mistake, not Euclid's mistake. We have to make sure that R and S are not both odd. Is that true? Can R and S both be odd?
No.
No, because of the same reason that, I mean, where are we? We had assumed that X is odd and Z is odd. Where are we? X is odd, so S and R cannot both be odd. Similarly, Z is odd, so and R, S are not, I mean, GCD, R, S is 1 and R and S are not both odd. We have proved that at least what Euclid claimed, the if part, we have arrived at. So do you agree that we have completed the proof of Euclid's theorem on Pythagorean triple, primitive Pythagorean?
Yes.
Fine. So let me just get down to quickly to, we have 3 minutes or 5 minutes left. I don't know how much Guru will give me extra, but let me just quickly mention Fermat's putative, or maybe he had it in his writings, proof of Fermat's last theorem for n equal to 4. So what does n equal to 4 say? X power 4, sir. Has no integer solution, no non-zero. If one of them is zero, it's gone. Non-zero integer solutions. That is Fermat's last theorem for n equal to 4. Remember, we have infinitely many n's to go cover, so there was no hope of us proving it in any case. Besides, the proof of Andrew Weil was 140 pages of like extremely advanced math, which I personally find it difficult to read. So I don't think I'll be able to explain that anyway. I was, if for those who are interested, I can explain Sophie Germain's proof, which is the next highest step. She proved it for n up to 100 actually, in a very simple, nice fashion. Or not 100, much more than that, but anyway, for sure up to 100. Okay, now, how do we prove this? So Fermat's strategy is what is called infinite descent. That is, you start with, suppose there exists a solution, suppose not. So we start with a wrong assumption, like we did in irrationality proof, right? We start with a putative solution and we start with a primitive solution, basically.
Proof by contradiction, sir.
Proof by contradiction, exactly. That's the word we really have to use. So suppose we get a solution. Suppose x, y, z is a primitive solution like we always had. So primitive word comes up here also. This is also homogeneous polynomial. So if any one number divides all of them, you can just eliminate it and get down to the one where the GCD is one. The primitive solution, then we will exhibit, or Fermat exhibited, we will exhibit another non-zero. So this is a non-zero basically. Primitive means non-zero, I suppose that's understood. You started with the non-zero one and you scale it down to a primitive solution. We will exhibit another one which is like U, V, W, such that W is strictly less than Z. So right now primitive solution with X, positive X, Y, Z, all positive, let's just put it that way. Or at least Z is positive, let's just make Z to be positive. So, I mean, some way to what is called the descent. Suppose we have a solution which is primitive, of course, we are able to do some vague tricks to get down to something which is smaller. In some sense, there are three. Okay, are we okay, Guru? We are done actually, 8 o'clock. How much more time are you willing to give me, or how much patience do the students have?
So it depends on the students. I think maybe 10 minutes we can go.
I will try to summarize in 5 minutes. Those who are have had their are full can leave. But let me just, you know, complete this, at least what Fermat would have himself, hold on, sorry. Okay. What Fermat himself would have had in mind, that's the thing. So he has probably written this down somewhere and given it as a challenge to others. But what he was trying to do was he was trying to do something simpler. In some sense, he was trying to find a solution for Z square. We could have used algebra and stuff like that even in this setup. I would recommend that you try the same thing that we did for Pythagorean triples. Let's keep Y on one side, take that X to the other side, factorize it, and see what you can conclude. I would like you to try that. But Fermat was was cleverer, or maybe he kept trying, and he came up with this simpler version. The simpler version, he's saying that even this equation will not have a integer solution. I mean, as you can see that this, whatever is power 4 will actually be the square of something, right? So even if you write square of something, not a power 4, even if it's the square of something, you will be in big trouble. And this is how he proceeds. So suppose X, Y, Z, if so, take a solution which is non-zero, primitive, etc. Then X square, Y square, and Z is a PPT. So basically, you get it? This is X square to the square, Y square to the square, and Z square, of course. So this is, we are back in Pythagorean triple situation and primitive also. So what does that mean by Euclid's argument? X square, so let us just take any one of them to be even and odd, etc. It doesn't really matter. X square this time is R squared minus S squared. Y squared is 2R squared S squared. And Z, see, X squared is this whole thing, this thing here, so I wrote it down. Y squared is this whole thing. And Z, of course, is R squared plus S squared. We can't stop here, and of course, R and S relatively prime odd. We have all that condition, right? So let's just keep it by the side and see where we go from here. So already you see another Pythagorean. So already we have a square business here. We do have a square business here, and we can exploit whatever we wanted. So you just choose which of them is odd and which of them is even you feel like. So let, again, R is even. It's up to you. You can choose the other case. It will not hurt you much, except that, yeah, you will have to have a plus minus factor coming here. So you have to be careful. Let's just assume that R is even to start with. And S is odd. Okay, so we know that both can't be even and both can't be odd. So let R be even. How does that help? Anyway, so let's just take Y, which is well known to be even. Y by 2 square, so R is equal to 2m, say. Y by 2 square is, another 2 will come here. M square S square. Okay. We are still in the similar situation. Is this fine? Something seems to be.
Sir, Y square is 2RS, no, sir?
RS. Thank you very much. You have made my day. Thank you very much. Yeah. This was totally like, yeah, out of the curve. So we have to really focus on this only. I really got carried away. I was so attracted that this forward. Okay, we have to get to this situation. So X squared plus S squared is R squared, right? And there we have the primitive business. Already R and S were relatively prime, so we can conclude that this is another primitive Pythagorean triple. Sorry. And X was odd to start with, right? So X is therefore, remember X squared is R squared and Z squared, but X is M squared minus N squared. S is now 2MN. Thank you very much. You just saved me so much time. Or you people are actually more aware of time than me. So one problem I started working on, and I'm still working on it after 9.5 years. I don't know. Time just seems to go by, and the problem is not yielding. It's boxing me back. Okay. Now that we have all this, can we put it together? So S is equal to 2MN. Let's just substitute here. So Y square equal to 2 times R into S. So we do have, how do we conclude? We have to have a product being equal to a square here. Let's product being equal to a square, S. So I would, since you're saying that we have very less time left, I would like to leave this as an exercise for the interested kids. How do we get down to a Pythagoras-like situation, Euclid-like situation, where a product of two relatively prime numbers is a perfect square? One of these will give you the answer, but I am not very sure which. Y square, you have to use that. This is the Y square, 2mn into, so that 2 of course goes off, mn into. I would leave it down to you. Actually, you will find it on Google everywhere. But my advice to you would be to get a flavor of this kind of math that comes up. Just struggle with it a little. It's not difficult at all. I'm sure you will find your place where the product of two relatively prime numbers is a perfect square. And you will be able to conclude that individually M and N is also one of these. Something is a perfect square, I think. Therefore, when you substitute here, you will have fourth power. You will get back to your original situation, which was a solution of this. So you have to finally get down to this situation. You will already know that R is a perfect square, right? We have to, if you can prove that R is a perfect square, I will leave it to you. This is so delicious, actually. It's just a step, one more step. You can think on the feet. I'm unable to think on my feet, but a small step and we will be on the moon. Actually, we would have completed Fermat's last theorem for n equal to 4 if you figure out which of these equations to box into a corner. So shall I leave it as an exercise, Guru? What do you think?
Yeah, I think so. And for n is equal to 3, maybe even harder, isn't it?
N is equal to 3 is definitely harder. Euler himself tried all these tricks and he had some mistake. But it could still be a worthy exercise for, it's more difficult actually. Why not? You can write to me if you feel like discussing it any further. Usually one goes into the cubic, you do more algebra actually to handle the case 3 and higher, but why not try the 3 case? I have tried it myself, definitely. It's within anyone's reach actually, the 3 case also. So, okay, I will stop here. You can ask some further questions if you wish. And yeah, I'll start presenting.
So what I would like to, you know, just to pinpoint or talk about a little bit is basically students of maths, no, the fundamentally, you'll have to understand from this discussion, I think one of the most important thing that you can take away is that proof is very, very important in maths. When at every statement you make, unless there is a proof that you already know how to do it, or you have something in your mind about that, you cannot trust the statement. Okay, for any statement, any mathematician, you can see that they are always interested in proofs. They want to know, they're from somewhere, something they know from there to here how to come. They have to know the mathematical steps. So whenever you talk about talk to any mathematician, you will see that it is all about proofs. That is why today also you realize, apart from a few minutes of history, everything else was proofs. Okay, so I could see Krishnan was very uncomfortable on the history part, but he had to deliver.
Euclid, the way he has written his book, we don't know. I don't know if you know, but I have no idea of Euclid's history. But it's his books that really matter, and his books are like so models of precision. Actually, proofs, when we say every statement is justified, there is not one statement which is unjustified. Of course, Fermat, as we said, he was writing in his own notebook, so he didn't need to convince anyone. Others, Euclid, for example. Yeah, Guru, go on.
So people who are interested in basically perceiving any kind of maths, you know, they have to get into the rigor of maths. And some of our earlier students, like for example, I talked to Vishnu. Vishnu is here with us, and also I don't know if Medha has joined or not. Medha is also there. I think they understand that. They have been working in maths for some time. They are in CMI doing work, and they are able to see that every statement, when you talk about what is the proof, they want to get that. So they have a clear understanding of every proof. So newly who are getting into math, you have to understand that it is not just about, you know, somehow getting something. It is about perfectly doing it. And Krishnan gave us some examples of that, and you are going to also, class 11 students are going to actually learn a lot from, Chakrapani sir will actually start the number theory part in the next week, or maybe I think the next month. So that's when he'll introduce you to all this modern theories and all. Chakrapani sir also is here. Chakrapani, can you please switch on your video? I just want to introduce you to Krishnan.
So he's our
maths. He teaches maths for 11th standard children. And he does very nice work with the number theory. And I called him today to basically to see how did you feel today's class.
Yeah, so Krishnan sir was really, you know, he was able to reach out to the level of students. Though he is actually hovering in clouds even higher than that, he is able to present things in a such down-to-earth way. is very inspiring for me, the way you can connect to students at all levels. So that was very inspiring to me.
Very nice. And so Vijay, you want to say anything? How was it?
I was on mute. I didn't realize that. Hello, sir.
Hello.
For me personally, it was quite enlightening, because one of the things, I mean, though I am an extreme amateur in mathematics, one of the things that had really got me hooked on was how we prove that root 2 is an irrational number. See, that is where this basically start with M and N, proof by contradiction, lead to a fact that M and N can't be both even at the same time. I mean, that's where I had started. So, I mean, to come back to this, the way you went about proving that, why we need to start from GCD and go on. For me personally, it was engaging. But at the same time, I was sitting with my son who has just finished 9th. So I was also sensing that there was some handholding required here to keep him hooked on as long as possible. So,
I would like to say that, this is something I felt the school, they introduced GCD in class 4. LCM or whatever you want to call it, without any context back, behind or in front also. It's only to add rational numbers to the denominator and numerator, etc. And they spend too much effort on how to do mixed fractions and such things. They lose complete track of whatever GCD and number theoretic aspects of that.
It becomes almost ritualistic.
It takes some time to get back into that.
So, but having said that, it was very engaging, very good. So thank you.
So, Krishnan, I would also, request you sometime later, maybe Vishnu and other people can be there, whoever are interested. I mean, ultimately, it is about not everybody can do the math in the same rigor. Some children may be very, very interested in doing more. So, such children, actually, I will later figure out who are they and try to get you to talk to them on other areas.
Like this irrationality we were talking about. I have a lot more to say about irrationality. Even about root 2, I can fill an hour of lecture
on root 2.
Various proofs of apart from this
proving root 2 would be useful even for other students.
If you want me to suddenly go on, I would warn. I'll warn the other students before moving on after root 2. But root 2, I still have a lot to say, actually.
Yeah. I mean, sir, if possible, at a later point of time, if we can have a session wherein we can really illustrate the interplay of geometry and this number,
theory, that is really advanced, actually.
Okay, at least, okay. I mean, even geometry and algebra, when geometry we talk about the solution of an equation versus graphs getting at various points, or partitions on a number line versus finding these, sets, that would be nice. To get this to see that, if you can have a session like that sometime,
Guru will tell me. But geometry and number theory is actually quite a modern topic. After Andrew Wiles, as we said, started it, it's called arithmetic geometry. We are all, as people like me and all, are a very low level. There is very high level work going on in that field. Even field medalists do come out, like Akshay Venkatesh is one of them. Manjul Bhargava is another of them, and so many such people. It's a cutting edge, actually. So nothing bad about it. I'm just saying it's very advanced even for me. But I'm sure there are topics that we can explore where we can have an idea of that.
See, some things those who are not formally into mathematics, we just hear them more of like stories. For example,
easily one can find out topics to discuss in that direction.
Yeah. See, for example, you can't trisect a 60-degree angle. Mm-hmm. Now, this actually maps to the fact that cos 20 cannot be constructed. I mean, it starts like a geometrical problem, but finally we end up doing a lot of
algebra.
I know it only to this extent. But I don't know, is it even possible to explain it without we having certain prerequisites? but if possible, if this interplay can be illustrated, that would be nice.
Definitely, we can find topics.
Yeah.
It will be exciting for me also. Guru, sometime later we can think about it.
Yeah, we'll discuss and see what else. Okay. So great. So we had a, you know, for me, how time passed, I don't know. I loved it, but you know, time is fast. You know? We had to stop at 8. So thanks, Krishnan, for you know, giving that such a nice time for us. And we look forward to more of those things. Guys, I hope you know you all were able to you know be with it, at least you know you understood at least major part of it, and I hope and you know, I generate.
I would like you to just try and complete that last part without looking at any other sources. Yeah. That will be nice.
Definitely. Okay guys, thanks a lot. So if you Krishna, whatever you written down,
I will send it. Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.